2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6. Thank you for standing already. I didn't have to say anything. We want to stand for the Word of God in this house. Not for the pastor, for the Word. For this reason, I remind you. Now, you don't have to remind somebody of something that they don't forget. I think in some of the middle of our chaos and confusion, our distractions or our hurts, we tend to forget. Is why the Lord is telling us that I'm going to remind you, you fan into flame. You fan into the flame, the gift of God. I know somebody could take me to task about this theologically, but I don't think I'm taking too much liberty on this, because we know that, yes, in direct context, it's talking about Paul and the elders of the church, the presbytery, laying hands upon Timothy and imparting spiritual gifts. But the Lord also says, the Lord Jesus says, wait for the promise of my Father, the gift, which is the Holy Ghost. And we're going to talk about that today. Fan into flame the Holy Spirit that has been given to you. Instead of going into a dark place in your mind and thinking about what's wrong with everything, start thinking about what's right with everything. Start praising Him in spite of it. I guarantee you, He's well aware of what's going on. And I'm not making light of serious things that may be happening in your life, but the Lord wants to remind you to fan into flame. In other words, you need to get passionate again. Get passionate about the Word of God. Get passionate about His promises. Get passionate about His covenant. Get passionate about how much He loves you. Get passionate about how He can protect you. Get passionate about how He's going to take care of you. Get passionate about how He just wants to spend time with you. Because when you start, whatever you magnify grows. Have you ever gotten a lens of, oh, hallelujah, help me, Jesus, not to get too far off track. You can take a telescope and you can look through one end and something really small way out there, and you can look through it and all of a sudden it gets big. Well, you can take that same telescope and turn it around and look at something real close and it looks far away or it looks small. So it's all about your perspective, because what you focus on and what you want to grow more in your life will. Now, we can't make God any bigger, but you can make Him bigger and more active in your life by fanning the flame of God. Father, help me to review quickly today, to get to new material, to get everybody situated and out to eat so we can enjoy the fellowship of the food together, Lord. This is going to be a great message today. Thank you for imparting things into me. Thank you for showing me, because apart from you, I can do nothing. I'm not that smart. Thank you. I depend on you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. We give you glory, honor, and praise, Lord Jesus. Thank you for this awesome word. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said amen. You may be seated in the presence of God. In this series, we're learning that God starts the fire. See, you can't do God's part and He won't do yours. God starts the fire, but man sustains the fire. It's up to you to fan the flame. And we were talking in this series that fanning the flame means your passion. Of all the things that it can be symbolic of, we're focusing on the symbolism of passion. Fanning your passion for God. You see it in newlyweds. They're all over each other. We talked about that on the honeymoon. They might not even get out of the room. Amen. True passion, it can be seen. Because a true passion will last a lifetime, but a phase will fizzle out. There's a lot of people dropping out of love, dropping out of marriage, dropping out a lot of things, even their jobs or hobbies or something, because it was just a phase. It wasn't a passion. Because phases fizzle out. And they let their feelings get in the way. Based on feelings, you will have a phase. And if you have a phase, you will fizzle out. Guarantee. I see it all the time with giving guitar lessons. They come in, they got a new guitar, and they're smiling from ear to ear, and they say, I want to play guitar. But then they, listen, they start learning what it's going to actually take. And so you found out really quick whether it was a phase or whether it was a passion. Because if it was a phase, listen, you find out that they only like the idea of that. I can see myself playing guitar in my head. I like the idea of it, but now I do all that? Really? Oh, No. And I see that in people's lives too. I just use that as an example. People wanting to get out of poverty. Got real quiet real quick. Well, there's things you got to do. Because everybody likes the idea of having a little extra jingling going on in your pockets. But then when you find out from somebody who has been there and done that, went from absolutely nothing, ain't even got two pennies to rub together, can't even pay attention, hallelujah, and find out what it took to finally get where they're at. So many people, they want what somebody has and still, instead of being willing to find out what they did to do what they got. You can have what I have if you do what I do. And then you find out really quick whether it's just a phase that'll fizzle out. And then you just settle down into your norm or your comfort zone. Amen. Or whether it's a true passion and you're willing to do whatever it takes to climb out of that hole. Like I said, this is applicable to anything in your life. You just fill in the blank. It's a principle. A passion will last a lifetime, but a phase will fizzle out. We learned that a lot of people in your life, we talked a lot last week about when not to let a flame start to fan. In other words, there's times that there's some flames you just need to let go out. Quit trying to keep that fire going. That ain't going nowhere in your life. With the scripture, which get that ready, guys, because we're going to hit it. We might hit it on the front end again. 1 John 2:19. Some people were sent into your life and some people just went into your life. In other words, there's no divine mandate for their mission. Be careful who you let in your life. Because even though you might be real serious, you might be their phase that fizzles out.
Amen.
And then you're left, amen. Can't re-preach it. When they can leave you, let them go. Because your destiny is not tied to anyone that left.
Yes.
Did you hear me?
Yes.
Quit crying. Pick yourself up. Yes, you got investments. Yes, it cost you. Yes, there was blood, sweat, and tears. Yes, you have the memories. But if they can just leave and walk out, let them go. Your destiny is not tied to them. They just come into your life, but it was no divine mandate. Just let it go. Yes, He will mend your broken heart. Yes, your heart will get broken. Yes, it will hurt, but it can be mended.
Yes.
Your destiny is not tied to anybody that left. It's no accident they walked away. So we need to learn to develop the gift of goodbye. Develop that gift. It's amazing in the church how forever and a day, and you know, if it's a Bible-believing church coming out of the Word of God, it needs to be instilled from a young age that you welcome people. And that's a whole other message. I might accept you, but I don't have to accept what you do.
That's right.
I accept your life, but I might not accept your lifestyle. So I want to welcome you in, and I want to, we always learn how to fan the flame of loving on people. And remember, love's not the different than trust. I may love you, but I might not trust you. I might love you, but I might not agree with you.
Yeah.
Don't get it mixed up.
Yeah.
And so we're good at welcoming people into our lives, but it's not been taught very much about how to develop the gift of goodbye as people exit our lives. We've not been taught that very often. We think everybody comes into our life is supposed to be there forever. Some things are only seasonal. We had an awesome series 2 years ago called Stop the Madness. Go back and watch that. Go back and watch that. It's a relationship series. It'll get put things in perspective. You can find it. It's been a while, but you can find it. Amen. Stop begging people to stay. Let them go. You need to fan into flame the one who doesn't change, the one who will never forsake you, the one that loves you with an everlasting love, the one you're his pleasure, and he desires for your prosperity. That's who you fan the flame for, amen? And so we talked about that last week, about some that you don't need to fan. But let it burn out. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. So this week, listen, let's talk about those who try to fan a flame that's not even there. Because I see that going on too. Let the Spirit of God be your witness on everything that I'm going to say today, okay? And I believe that there are many who profess Christ but have never met him. Yes. And Scripture bears that out. Throw up Matthew 7, 22 and 23. Many. Am I reading that right? Y'all got your Bibles out? What does y'all say there? What's the first word y'all say? Not just two or three, not just a small percentage. Many. Listen, and you wonder why every week pastor got to get up and have an altar call for salvation every week. This is why. Not on my watch, not in this house. You will have an opportunity to give your life to Jesus in this house every week. Not just on special occasions. Not just on Easter and Christmas. Amen. Because we know we got them CEOs. Christmas, Easter only. That's what it stands for. But many will say unto me. This is Jesus talking. In that day. That day, there is going to be that day. Lord, Lord. Listen to them. Have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have we cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Verse 23. And then I will profess unto them. I'm going to have my say in this now. I never knew you. I never knew you. I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Throw up Luke 6:46. Luke 6:46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? So, there's a lot of people who just profess the Lord in word only. And as stated in the earlier message, they went out from, because they were never really with. Throw that back on the screen too, 1 John 2:19, when I had you to get ready for me earlier. They went out from, for if they had been with us, they would no doubt have continued with. They went out from, because they were never really with. Not everybody who is around you is with you. And let all my adults say amen. You've probably experienced that more than once in your lifetime. And they may honor with their lips, but not with their heart. Matthew 15:7-8. Matthew 15:7-8. Ye hypocrite. You know what? I'm just going to tell you. If you read the Word of God, Lord have mercy. Sometimes we just take our favorite parts that we like and we just don't want to read the other parts out. But there's times when Jesus, the loving, kind Jesus, the one who left the 99 to get the one, the one who always hears your prayers, is in a group of people calling them hypocrites, and even in one place calling them a brood of vipers. See, I'd love it because all this fake news outlets out there would love to get a hold. If Jesus Christ walked the face of this earth today, they'd be on him like white on rice. All over it. Can you believe that? And he said he's supposed to be a man of God, pointing fingers and calling hypocrites and vipers. I'm moving on from that. Well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, verse 8, this people draws nigh unto me with their mouth. If every person, especially some of the places that we outreach to in ministry, that ever said to us that I'm going to be coming to your church, if they showed up, every one of them showed up at the same time on any given Sunday, as of now, we wouldn't have enough chairs to hold them. We would have to pull our, well, we could hold them, but we have to pull the reserves out. Because there's a lot of people that say a lot of things. Talk is cheap. I mean, really, I mean, I'm at the point in my life where I'm getting older. Not old, praise God. I'm getting older to the point where I just really don't care about people's opinions and stuff anymore. And I've had people that might think I have a bad attitude, but they'll shoot me a bunch of, just full of a bunch of hype and exaggerations and this and that and the other. And, you know, I'll give them the time of day to listen to them. I don't want to be disrespectful, but I ain't believing a word they say. You don't tell me, show me. Regardless of what it is. Oh, Pastor, we going to do this for the church. Okay. One ear and out the other until a few weeks go around. Let's see it. Amen. Or whether it's even in personal life. Am I the only one that's experienced that in this room?
No.
Amen. I just want to make sure. Y'all got real quiet on me again. So to make sure that I'm not talking, because I don't ever want to talk over your head about something. I think one thing that's hurt this society is a bunch of people who are highly educated getting to a church and they're talking everybody's head and they don't understand what they're saying. My job is to communicate the Word of God to you in such a way that you grab a hold of something when you walk out the door that you can apply to your life. Say amen if that's you. Amen. And so, anybody can honor you with mouth. Anybody can say anything. I mean, really, I can sit here and say anything. And the crazy as our society is today, I used to give this example a long time ago, but society has already upped me. I used to say, you know, I could tell somebody that I'm the world's heavyweight wrestling champion. No, you're not. Says who? I said I was. So therefore, I am. And you might believe it. People around you like, you know, I don't know about all that. And so it usually goes this day. What, you say I'm a liar?
Yeah.
But see, the world's already upping me in this one. They've already upped me on this one. I'm a girl. No, you ain't. You a boy. If you got seed, you a man. If you got a womb, you're a woman. Yeah, I did go there.
Yeah.
And I'm not afraid to go there either.
Yeah.
As long as it's in the world. I don't understand absolutely 100% all of it, but if it's in this book, I don't care. From Holy Bible to bonded leather, we will cover it. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. So you can say anything with your mouth. And they honored me with their lips, but what? Their heart is far from me. Their heart. Because that's where, if the heart's there, you'll see a lot of the show and do and not a lot of the hear and say. Amen. So, they that profess Christ but do not possess Christ. Let me say that again. There's those that profess Christ, but they do not possess Christ. Boast of a false gift. And that's the gift of the Holy Ghost. Knowing that the Lord, which is life eternal, knowing Him. Let's shoot up John 17:3 real quick. John 17:3. And this is life eternal. Well, what is eternal life? Well, here's the definition. That they may know, gnosko, intimacy, experience. Not just heard something, experienced. Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. That's life eternal, to know, to experience Him. Not just the lip service. Not I've heard about Jesus. I have met and I know Jesus. Throw up Romans 8:9. This gets some that are just religious. This will get them every time. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Listen, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. That'll separate those who know Christ from those who just got a good dose of religion on their life. Well, you know, is the Holy Ghost in you? Oh, well, no. I mean, gosh, if the Holy Spirit was in me, my life would be so much different. I mean, exactly. It would be. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, read that last one. He is none of His. It's not for the select saints, the sanctified saints, the called of God saints. The Holy Ghost is for every believer. If you have not the Spirit of Christ, you're none of His. But I go to church, none of His. How do we know? The Spirit of Christ. Because it's no longer you in you, and you know that. Amen. Glory be to His name. Hallelujah. Because those who just profess and they don't possess, they're like clouds without rain. In other words, they profess something, but they can't produce anything. Why? Because you don't have the right seed in you. Oh, who am I speaking to today? Glory be to God. I wish somebody would have preached this to me when I was a young man, and I wish I had enough wisdom to listen to it. I don't go out and plant cucumbers in my yard, and I'm nervous about if it's going to produce corn. Now, I do like corn, but I'm just trying to make an example here. I hope corn don't pop up. I put that seed in the ground. Well, what kind of seed did you put in there? A cucumber seed? Well, why in the world do you think corn is going to pop up? Well, you just never know what them seeds, it goes in the ground, you can't see it. You just never know what might pop up. See, when you bring natural stuff in there, it sounds funny to somebody. But there are spiritual laws that are just as real. Everything will produce after its own kind. If you do not have the Holy Spirit, which is the seed of God in you, then you can't produce anything of God out of you. That's why. If there is not a change, there was not a change. You can profess it all day long. But if you don't have that seed, you can't produce anything. The fruit of the Spirit. I charged you last week. I'm going to hit it real quick again. That most people, when they go out to look for a mate or a job or it, just fill in the blank again, whatever you're searching for, usually we look for either personality traits or benefits or attributes that benefit us. Well, they have a beautiful smile. Oh, her eyelashes, when she bats them, she makes me melt. Oh, his shoulders are so broad. When's the last time that when you went out to search for somebody and you when you went to your BFF and said, well, baby, how did it go on that first date? Oh, I saw so much love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, meekness, self-control, and faithfulness, which is the fruit of the Spirit. You can't have a fruit if you don't have a seed. And if the Spirit of Christ is not in you, it don't matter how much smack they can talk. Hey, I've been in prisons where I've talked with people when I first got into the ministry that could run circles around me in this book. And at the end of the conversation, when I felt about this tall, this is what kind of made me feel like I was dropped, kicked off the planet, was at the very end of it all, they're like, I don't believe in that God stuff anyways, though. Because they've spent so many years in that book, they know the book. Listen, but they don't know the author. And you can take somebody like that can debate you all day long and have all the intellectual knowledge, but they don't have him in their heart. So they can talk to you about that book all day long. Listen, but you take me, a 7-year-old who knows the power of the Holy Ghost, who got saved, and they can go and they might not be able to debate and connect the dots, but they can go lay hands on the sick and they recover. Are you hearing me? The works that they do. Why? Because that seed is of God. You can't debate a healing. Well, I'm going to go visit them in the hospital and I'm going to just give them my exegesis on this and my doctrinal dissertation and I'm going to get it out and I'm going to tell them, and they're going to be so awe and amazed that they're going to jump out of the bed. No, they need the living God which dwells in you. Because if you be of Christ, the Holy Spirit is inside of you. Whew, hallelujah. That's what I want to be around. Bunch of posers. I don't want to be around a bunch of posers. I want to reach out to the posers. Amen? We want to get them. We don't want them posing no more. We want to bring them on in. We want to bring them on into the kingdom. Amen? Proverbs 25:14. Hallelujah. My remote control. There we go. Nope. Try again. Yep. Whoso boasteth himself. Once again, there's that lip service. Talk. Of a false gift. And like I said, I know I'm asking for a little bit of liberty here. If I had time, I could tie it in there. Because remember, the Holy Spirit is a gift to us. He's God's gift to us. Who boasts himself of a false gift is like clouds and wind without rain. When you're in a drought in your life, you know what you need? You need some rain.
Yes, you do.
But what happens is people get hooked up. They get hooked up with some clouds, and they get hooked up with some wind, and when they really need it, they don't get no
rain.
Hallelujah. You need to get hooked up with somebody. Hey, come on, Peter. It's got some rain in their life, so when a drought hits, amen. We got so many people like that today, don't we? I don't have no problem saying if I don't know, I don't know. I even have that sometimes. Pastor, what do you think about this? And they'll go into some kind of doctrinal something or another, and I've not been hitting that this week. I've got a lot going on. I got to feed the house, and I got to feed myself. Whatever they had is just not on my radar, and I can say I don't know. That doesn't mean that I can't find out, but what it does mean is that I don't know right now, and right now it's not on my high priority list. You go study it out, amen? I don't know right now. I might. Some things I do because I've studied it and I've been through it. Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost will pull out what you need when you need it. Even the Master said, when you brought in front of people, don't think ahead of time what you're going to say. Let the Holy Spirit minister it. A lot of people try to do his job too much around here in this world, don't they? Even believers. Amen. That's tight, but that's right. One encounter with the living God. I'm talking about a true You have not, you've just been in a Holy Spirit environment, because that's one of the parts of our vision, to set an atmosphere to experience Holy Spirit. You can know something's going on the outside, but have you really experienced it on the inside? See, I've been around some atheists before when there was something going on and somebody, it was a secular event, but then the person leading it was a really strong Christian. He was doing a guitar seminar, and so everybody come out because he's like bad to the bone. He good, he real good. And he was just tearing it up, and then halfway in it, he just stopped and started giving a small testimony about the Lord and what the Lord's done for him, and he started singing a gospel song. And there was an atheist standing by during that going like, what's going on in here? It just feels different in here. They could sense something's going on. So they could tell it on the outside, but I don't know if they have yet or not, but praise God, they at least to that night, they didn't let him on the inside. So there's a difference and a profession and a possessing of the Lord. One encounter with the living God is more powerful, and it's more fulfilling. One moment, and more transforming, listen, than 60 years of intense theological studies that stimulate the mind but never penetrate the heart. And we put too much, I am not against education, but we put way too much emphasis on those that have a good head and not have a right heart. I'm telling you, all over, we have it going on right now, all over the nation, God has got prophets that are speaking things, true prophets. Let me stop, just let me clarify that. Everybody that says a prophet ain't a prophet. Sorry to bust the bubble. You can put any kind of a label on an empty can. It goes back to what I said earlier. You can call yourself whatever. But if you a prophet, guess what kind of fruit you're going to produce? Why? Because God's put that seed in you. And it's going to come out. But we have a whole lot of other people. And I'm not saying they're bad, they're ugly, they're wrong, jacked up, or they're not Christians. So I'm not saying that. I'm not hating on anybody. But you got those with more degrees than a thermometer that get a big old microphone that gives you a lot of intellectual head knowledge, and a true prophet of God will be over there, and he ain't got a microphone, but he's still going to get it out and proclaiming what God's saying in the earth today. So do you want more intellectual understanding, or do you want some divine direction? Oh, my Lord. Hallelujah, praise his holy name. Knowing about the Lord and knowing the Lord are two totally different things. One is with the head, the other is with the heart. Listen, the head can tell you all about his goodness, but the heart can show you all of his goodness. Oh, it pierced my heart one time. Whew. About loving people. Amen. I can't. He said not to go there on that today. But the head can tell, but the heart will show. And a historian may be able to tell you all about the adventures, tell you all about the successes, and tell you all of even the failures in the life of Billy Graham. They may be able even to do that in chronological order, from cradle to grave. A historian can tell you all about his life. But Ruth Graham, his wife, could tell you what he was thinking. Just by one look at his countenance and his mannerisms and his body language and his tone, how could she do that? She's not got nearly as many degrees as this historian who writes such profound paragraphs and pages in the book. Why? It's because she didn't just have interviews and sessions with him. She spent her life with him. She knew him. She just didn't have casual interviews and be an acquaintance. She knew him. And that's why God will use more ex-junkies. He will use more prostitutes, ex-prostitutes, ex-perverts, ex-liars, ex-thieves. He'll use more of the uneducated. He'll use those that had been poverty-stricken. He'll use more people that were in false religions, and that's anything outside of Christianity. I don't care what you call it. Anything out there, one way. Anybody that comes out of a cult, and he will use more people, even more ex-atheists, because we all were atheists at one point in time, to turn the world upside down for his namesake and his kingdom. Amen. Just to clip it on that, just throw up 1 Corinthians 1:26. I can't spend too much time on it. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many, there's that many again, not many are going to be wise. Not many are going to be mighty. Not many are going to be noble. Hallelujah. So he'll use more Forrest Gumps and Bubba Gumps more than he will the pedigree. Amen. So he uses more of those who have been raised, listen, those that have been raised and churched and live a relatively safe and sanctified and clean and holy life. You can just go through the scriptures. Jesus just don't pick them as often. Oh, Peter was a man's man. Before he met Jesus, you wouldn't have want to met him after work in an alley, bumped into him and called him a name. He'd take you out, probably. A man's man. I mean, Peter didn't play around. Listen, when he told, yeah, I'm going to hit this for a second because I got a minute or two. People give Peter a hard time for denying Christ, and he did. But before he denied him, listen, he said, I will defend you even to the death. He did that. He was good to his word. When the crowd come out to take Jesus, Peter drew a sword, and listen, he wasn't aiming for that guy's ear. He meant what he said. I'll go to battle and I'll die for you, Jesus. What caused the denial was that Jesus says, put up your sword. And he says, we ain't going to do it that way. And Peter here was willing to die for Jesus, and Jesus is just willing to go off and die. Yeah. And so, yeah, it just like did a 180 in his life. And just before we get too comical with that, it's happened to all of us too. You didn't know until later on, and you could see from what God was really trying to do and say. Amen. Peter, rough, foul mouth. You know them sailors are known for their foul mouths anyways. He was a roughin'. Matter of fact, the scripture even talks about that when him and the apostles were, after Jesus had risen from the dead and they were preaching the gospel, all the uppities and those that were the leaders in the religious sect at that time in the Sanhedrin even said, took note that they were uneducated and unlearned men. But they had been with Jesus. Woo, hallelujah. That's what qualifies you. Have you been with Jesus? He who is forgiven much loves much. Throw Luke 7:47 on there real quick. 7:47. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins which are, there's that word again, what? Many. It's amazing how the world looks at the word many and the scripture looks at many, and we have a different view on that sometimes. We need to get hooked up to his view. Her sins are many, but guess what? Are forgiven. For she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Faith works by love. Or it says faith works through love. If you don't have love, you're not going to operate in faith. It's God's fail-safe. Because anybody can intellectually know the keys to the kingdom, intellectually know the system of God, intellectually know how he operates, and intellectually try to do that. But without the right heart, faith won't flow. And in order to operate into the things of the kingdom, you have to operate in faith. Oh, catch a hold of this. This is why a lot of times that the people that people would choose are not the ones that God would choose. Because God don't look at the outer appearance. He looks at the heart. And he says, they don't have enough faith for it because their heart's not right. Yes, they were messed up, but my blood has forgiven them. I look at them as being clean. They have a lot of sins, and so they're forgiven a lot, so they have lots of love inside of them. They understand this, so faith is going to flow a stronger through them. Amen. Don't you golf course on the ninth hole clap. If you're going to clap for God, clap. Praise him. So that's why, don't ever look at somebody, well, how come they chose? I think it shows. You don't know their heart. You don't know what they've been through. You've been forgiven little. Well, Lord, I've been trying to live good for you all my life. So what are you saying, Pastor? You should teach your kids to be heathens from a young age? Absolutely not. But he who is forgiven little loves little. But him who's forgiven much loves much. And those will have the heart for God, and they know how good he is. They've come and taste and see. And so since their heart is full of love, that means their life will be full of faith. And Jesus loves to manifest himself and to use hard-headed heathens. Because remember, a phase will fizzle out. But a true passion will fan the flame. It'll last a lifetime. Because you can't leave the presence of the Holy God and not be changed. After their encounter with the living God, whether it was Enoch, Abraham, Joseph, Moses, Joshua, Samuel, Elisha, or David, Peter, Paul, or Mary, the mother of Jesus, or Mary Magdalene, or whether it was Mary and Martha, Lazarus' sisters, or whether it was the woman at the well in John chapter 4, they all forsook all to follow the Master. And they followed him all the days of their life. And some of them, it cost their life literally, not figuratively. And next week, I want to jump into that. Stand to your feet as the music plays. You can't fan a flame that's never been there. So before we depart today, I know I kind of said it already. But if you've not felt like fanning the flame for quite some time, and I'm talking about many months, not days, maybe you need to examine yourself whether you be in Christ. Because those who've had a true experience with God, a true encounter with the living God, had a passion about him all the days of their life. And so I want you to examine yourself whether you be in Christ or not. Maybe you've not given your life to Jesus. Maybe you've just heard a bunch of church stuff. You've just attended church all your life. I go to church. Well, yeah, but if you live in a garage, that doesn't make you a car. I got baptized when I was a kid. So you just got wet as a kid. Have you given him your life? Have you examined yourself? Whether you be in Christ or not. Because if you have been through hard times and hardships and you just don't have any desire to fan the flame, I propose to you, maybe you're none of his and you just went through lip service, but your heart was far from him. Or you just wanted a get out of hell insurance card. Or I just want to get out of my situation now, so we'll try this Jesus thing. Examine yourself whether you be in Christ or not. Because if you've had an encounter with the living God, you might be miffed for a little while, but it's like fire in your bones because it's just not you and you. He's in there and he's for you and he's not against you. And you'll get to the point where before you start telling him all about your troubles, you'll be at a point of repentance that you've not turned to him first and that you've not praised him like you should. But why? Because you love him and the desire is for him and him alone. And the things of this world grow strangely dim the closer that you get to him. Because you have had an authentic encounter with the living God.